Sports Analytics Conference. My name is Andy Felt. I'm the host of this particular session, and so we'll get started with our first speaker, Kyle Peterson. Kyle, after studying exercise and sports science at the University of Wisconsin-La Crosse, Kyle is currently pursuing a PhD in informatics at the University of Iowa. Welcome, Kyle.
Thank you. Thanks for being here. By no means, the fact that I'm standing here does not mean that I'm an expert at all. I'm still learning this stuff. It's a whole new world. So, as Andy alluded to, I'm currently at the University of Iowa. Been there for 2 years now. And my capacity right now on the data side of things is primarily to wear two different hats, one being an epidemiologist and the other being more of a performance analyst monitor. So today I'd like to talk through kind of where my mindset has been challenged and perhaps rerouted in the last couple years, and then we'll finish with some more empirical work. But with that, I'd like to start with, you know, in the literature, despite the vast devotion to musculoskeletal injury mitigation or performance augmentation, conventional investigations into the etiology of these injuries and performance have really struggled to push agendas with non-dynamic frequentist methodology, because these analyses are restricted by their inherent assumptions, which, right, ultimately attenuate interpretation and thus predictability of such events. So, alternatively, forecasted events that occur within really high-dimensional dynamic systems, right, like ourselves, really require a more sophisticated modeling approach and require robust computational power. Therefore, if sport practitioners really wish to curtail injuries or augment performance in such complex, nonlinear organisms, then the modeling that we employ must appreciate both the erratic internal milieu as well as the multifarious external mediators, right? Various feedback loops, dependencies between systems and responses, lag times, are really all important to capture if we really want to understand what is happening under the hood. Now, consequently, there has been a recent challenge toward the profession, calling for a shift in modeling strategies for appreciating this dynamic nature in sport. Now, really, in general, there are two antagonistic views concerning the epistemology of causality. There's a deductive, and there's the inductive. And sport has classically appeared through the deductive lens. So rather than deducing predictions from these set rigid hypotheses, right, and frequency statistics, and then comparing how well these predictions accord with what actually happened in the real world, rather an inductive approach starts by gleaning observations, discerns a pattern without confirmation bias, and this usually happens algorithmically, right? And then we can subsequently infer how the parameters relate to the biological phenomena being captured. However, we know that relying on parameters in isolation to detect maladaptive states has yet to be validated. So rather than shifting from risk factor identification to pattern recognition is being called upon. Okay. System-based thinking, for instance, which involves a high degree of conditional dependencies, right, timing of such relationships, have traditionally turned a more network-based approach, right, machine learning, to solve complicated problems that we are facing in sport. Take bioinformatics, for example. Gene coding, that's not a simple task. Or perhaps discerning the etiology of disease through millions of electronic medical records, right, that's a big question. Or even say the econometrics, right? What I'm getting at is each of these disciplines have used much more sophisticated modeling than sport. So why haven't we gone that route? Now, although this ideological influence has seemed to have a delayed entry into sport, we are undoubtedly gaining headway, right? The fact that we're having this conference here today is a sign that we are undoubtedly gaining headway. So let's get more, let's get back to earth here. Sorry, that was kind of a rant. how we get these, how we get these high-dimensional data sets. Okay, so athlete monitoring. Now, this definitely is not an exhaustive list by any means. Really, you can use your imagination to plug in anything you want in these boxes. But really, the goal of athlete monitoring is to capture how athletes are coping with the imposed stressors, right? Perhaps express unwanted fatigue, and allow practitioners to instigate appropriate interventions to combat maladaptation, right? So, again, like I said, relying on parameters in isolation is if you have to be validated. So using a more comprehensive, holistic approach to create a so-called web of determinants to elicit the insight regarding the readiness of a particular athlete is being called upon. Appreciating both the internal and external load, corroborating the subjective with the objective, can certainly help with these high-dimensional, predicting these high-dimensional systems, since there's so many things going on, this soup of complexity. Now, using high-dimensional data sets and network-based modeling, which we'll get into really shortly, can be very advantageous for practitioners when trying to determine if their athletes are adapting in the intended direction. Furthermore, practitioners planning the chronological sequence of training, say a coach, can theoretically simulate athlete responses to their multivariate interventions, right? It's pretty cool. So let's get into what these network-based systems mean. So, to prelude, the software that you'll see today is called Bayesian Lab. I'm not affiliated at all, but they do a great job of providing a GUI platform for network construction. A great feature of Simulatory Networks is that they allow practitioners, like I said, to test theoretical interventions, right, instead of relying on associative observations within data sets. So a Bayesian network, which is what we'll talk about today, presents a marriage between probability and graphical theory. This marriage or conjugation allows for very interpretable and flexible representations of probabilistic relationships, but more importantly, they have the ability to withstand omnidirectional interactions that are occurring within these dynamical systems. The product of a Bayesian network is called a directed acyclic graph, in which each node or variable is annotated with quantitative probability and are connected by arcs, representing direct dependencies between variables. As you see here, these terms, the construction of a network often applies a family metaphor. That is, when there's a directional arc from the former to the latter that is a parent of the child. This term spouse is in relation to the target variable or response variable, right? So we see this indirect relationship. That means if we supply evidence to, say, spouse 2, this will update our information of P2, which then update our information of the target, right? Which then update information for the child, if we perhaps care. What else can we say here, just around the same page? I think that's all I have right now. We'll finally get empirical here. So, again, I mentioned epidemiology. This is a sample simulatory network. I won't disclose the team, but this data was captured over 3 school years of monitoring data. So the 4 kind of categories here are wellness questionnaires, which are a whole list of questions. MegWave, if you're familiar, it's a HRV, heart variability, and CNS readiness monitoring. Catapult, GPS accelerometry, locomotive assessments, and then session RPE. So how to read this? This is a temporal network. That is, so T-3 is 3 days out from any given day that we're trying to forecast, 2 days out, day prior, and day of. Now again, what's really cool is that this was an inductive process, right? So machine learning, an optimization problem, but this really is physiologically plausible, which is awesome. So this, right now at the graphical stage, is just showing relative relationships, but now to add this probability layer, I have this video. So here we're entering into Bayesian Lab. So we see I just picked 4 random variables. We got RPE, acute chronic ratio, the day before. We got sympathetic day of, so mega wave, subjective sleep duration, and then so DC potential morning of. Now, so we notice in the blue, when the video starts, these are the prior beliefs, right? So prior probability distributions. When we click on a bin, so let's say right here we are above 1.1 acute chronic RPE, right? This will update the belief of injury occurring 3 days out. So you see we start at 3%. As we add in, as we instantiate variables, we are updating the belief that some unfortunate events may happen. Now, as far as relating this to the coaches, we're not going to say for any freshman has a 30% chance of injury today. No, it's just more, look, over the past few days, Sally Senior may, you know, the belief that an unfortunate event is going to occur. So again, but back to the simulatory part. So we see 3 days out, we can plug in different workloads. We can get more specific than just RPE, but and then simulate these responses, how the athlete is adapting. This is really neat. Now again, back to this being physiologically plausible yet inductive. Like there's no confirmation bias on the practitioner's part. This is those same variables, I believe, picked up most of the same variables. So in isolation, we're just like the functional relationship of these variables within injury. And what's so cool is that in the literature, what we're being sifted through multiple studies that this, but right, like so if you're familiar with Tim Gavitt's work, acute chronic workload ratios, right? So his boundaries, if you will, are 0.8 to 1.3 is optimal. And if you supersede that or go below that, you're flirting with more risk. Now, of course, these values may not be exactly the same, but the functional relationship is precise. And look, I mean, basically, I doesn't know what the hell Tim Gavitt is, but we can still sift out this relationship independently. Same with megawave DC potential. So megawave says between 9 and 45 millivolts. Well, again, like the exact values are a little bit off of that, but we see this. Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't even explain what these graphs mean. I'm so sorry. Okay. Well, let's hold on a second. These dashed horizontal lines are the prior beliefs. So remember, in the last video, the prior was 3%. This is our prior belief with no information. Gosh, I'm so sorry to describe this. So this is with no information. Now, if we supply evidence to be in this lower bin, perhaps on DC potential, this bar, that's our posterior distribution. That's our belief. So our belief of injury doubles when we are in this lower range, right? When there's suppressed range. Whereas if you're in this optimal range, we are seeing a decrease, so a protective mechanism is happening, right? That's what I was getting to with these relationships. Again, with acute chronic RPE, there's a protective mechanism of being in this optimal range. But then when you supersede that, the risk goes up. Okay? Sympathetic too, right? You don't want to be in this overly sympathetic state. You don't want to be too parasympathetic, right? Sweet spot. We see how stress 2 days out, see how potent that is when they record a, so low score is high stress. But again, that makes sense, right? If there's this perceived distraction going on, there's going to be some allostatic adjustments trying to, right, this psychoneuroimmunological triad going on. Right, so there's something happening. This is really cool stuff. Shifting gears here to more performance related. Again, this is not an exhaustive list of everything there is to do with performance monitoring. But again, just looking at this high dimensional system based methodology. So we see, again, I won't disclose the team, but you can use your imagination with what game stats, but again, we're looking at loads. These would be like catapult metrics, right? And how they affect both the subjective and objective internal loads. Again, peripherals to TMG is more tissue assessments. So how the load affects kind of everything in this web, and then how everything, again, relates to their performance. Perhaps some basic demographic information too. This is kind of a hierarchical. So these are actually the actual metrics. Then these latent variables kind of summarize what these metrics are telling us. And again, it makes plausible sense, but there was no confirmation bias on our end. These weren't picked out by hand. So again, just kind of questioning our views on stats and how we sift through how we ask the questions, I guess, right? It's kind of a big question here. So Sarah, really, that's all I have to provide. I want to keep it short because I wanted to interact with questions. Yes?
So we're working with a university and helping their strength and conditioning coach produce data. Not as sophisticated as what you're doing, but one of the challenges we run into is really rolling it up to where the coach is, finding it useful. They don't want to dive down into all of this data, and I'm just wondering if you have any best practices about how best just to net it out for the coaches.
For sure. So again, I don't have all the experience in the world, but thus far, I think a big takeaway of really to actually support coach is to, before you present any data, would be to say this is to support your decision-making process and not to replace you, right?
Yeah.
Of course, they're still the expert.
Right.
But to get to your question about the relay information, the system that we've found most applicable for most sports is have the strength coach sift through, so they get all the data like you're saying, and then they kind of funnel it to the most applicable to the decision-making process of the coach.
Okay, good. That's following up. We're doing something similar, so that validates that a little bit. Thank you.
Yeah, it's hard task. Not all coaches buy into all the monitoring either, so that may be a slower process, but definitely it's more fun when the sport coach is
And he is in this case.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
You mentioned something about simulation.
Yes.
Did I follow you right? You can plug in different workout regimes and see how it might impact their chance of injury and other parameters.
So backtrack. So the simulation here. So this in this temporal sequence. Again, now this is more of a global metric RPE, but. Yes, if you have certain parameters of, say, different types of practice loading, again, this is a team view, but at an athlete level, you can also have each node can be, okay, I want to look at Franny Freshman, how is she going to adapt? So again, if we plug in, okay, I want a high neural day, if you want a high neural day, if you capture that kind of data, and then have a lower day, right, you can simulate from prior experience, how if you're catching more internal metrics, you can simulate how they're perhaps adapting. Or if you plug in, right, if you want to just destroy them, right, we can see the cost of that through this dynamic belief updating. And also with this simulation, you can attach these nodes to a database, right? So as more data rolls in, these will dynamically, and this was a stagnant data set, for example, but this could propagate belief dynamically.
Thank you.
Is there any question?
Yes, thank you.
Awesome. Yeah.
Are you using that to set thresholds then for when they're at practice? You know what I mean? Because you said you can kind of predict off their load.
Yeah, so during practice, not so much. It's more of before practice.
So you're going to make the practice plan based on what you think.
Yeah, so altering all this data right before the PM practice, right? Coach may have plan A, but then some athletes may perhaps need plan B and C. So it's more of that acute monitoring, daily monitoring, adjusting, I should say. But yeah, not in practice, per se. Not yet, at least. Definitely not.
Hi, Sarah.
Hi.
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 Thank
you.
Do you keep track of whether or not coaches take your advice? Like if they have option A, B, and C, you take note if they actually choose B or C, so you know whether or not they're actually like using the information you're providing to make alterations to their practice, and whether or not those decisions are leading to positive outcomes.
That's a good question. So I'll say the track team is by far our earliest adopter with data. So they actually, with Megawave, that's pretty much what dictates practice for a lot of the kids. So so of course they have this macro plan, but every day could be completely different. So on the track side, for sure that happens. As far as recording, the adjustments.
We have not. Yeah.
That'd be a good idea though. To see, like from a load monitoring standpoint, wind ranking adjustments. Yes.
Do you have the capability, so all these predictions lead to injury, right? So on the
sure.
off chance, or hopefully not, but
right.
injuries happen, so someone gets injured, can you then reset? So say an injury occurred, right? So this plays out on that day, injury occurred, and your percentage of injury wasn't as high as you would have expected. It was 6%, 8%.
Sure.
Do you have the ability then to set that as the standard? Like that is the new high that you want to be reaching, and your numbers then get lowered because an injury was occurred at that lower rate, so then the lower rates are actually at higher rates.
Sure, so you're saying retrain this model.
Yeah,
for sure. So right now, BasalAB doesn't have a dynamic adaptive updating,
okay.
so we have to manually just relearn.
Gotcha.
Pretty much just throw this away to relearn and see what came up next. Which a lot of times it comes up very similar, but yeah, if some variable in the background was manifesting, it may come up later on, as you're saying, new data.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
The next step would be to somehow make it adaptive. That'd be pretty gnarly. Yes.
So on this table here, you're showing that T minus 3 days, that's basically an off day form, right? Because it's in blue. What you're trying to show there.
The color codes are just so you can see each day. The meaning of the color, there's no meaning.
There's no meaning
of
the color.
Yeah, it's just 3 days out, we can plug in stress and their external loading. And then 2 days out, again, stress and external loading. The midway parameters, right? Internal responses to these loads. So we can see how external absolute objective load is influencing their sympathetic response 2 days later, right?
So have you played with that at all, what your minus one looks like versus your minus two, or some programs are going to adopt more of taking Wednesdays off at the collegiate level for football,
mm-hmm.
and some are still kind of doing the traditional taking the Friday where they do walkthrough. Where they're doing walkthrough, keeping the load really low.
Yeah, so back to you're saying the simulatory.
So have you played with those, trying to figure out what's more optimal for your guys, with your periodization, with the practice plans?
Oh, I see. Really, it's about the acute adjustments. Yeah, because if a high-low-high works for one person one week, the next week, and you're in a new state, right? So they could perform better with a high-high-low that week, right? So it's all about the adaptive state on that day. What can you tolerate and what can you not?
So instead of just also looking at injury, then you can almost look at what's going to be their optimal, try to get with their optimal performance day on game days, then too, right?
Yeah.
So the counter.
Yeah, so that we've done with track is find, okay, so you can rank all these performances, right, and you can't hide and track. It's what you do is what you did that day. Whereas team sports gets a little murky, you can see, okay, when you tested in certain ranges, you performed excellent on these days, right? And you can simulate, okay, so then how do they get into those optimum ranges, right? So.
You guys play around with that too?
Oh, yeah, that's really fun. Really exciting.
Would track coaches choose lineups based off that data? If you have eight guys in your pool for the 4x4, would coaches look at this and be like, all right, these are the four guys that we're predicting are going to have optimal performances?
They've had people not compete to make way of the team.
Very cool.
Yeah. Really exciting.
It sucks to be the kids, right? But.
Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about the software you're using? Is it free subscription?
BasalAB?
Yeah.
It's not free. It's about $1,500 a year.
Fair enough.
If you're in an academic setting, if you're in a business setting, it's $3,000 a year.
Thank you.
Yeah. BasalAB. I think it's about slide when I have time to next speaker to set up. Unless anyone else has any questions.
Let's thank Kyler.
Yeah.